Penguin Random House Audio presents The Buccaneers by Edith Wharton, completed by Marion Mainwaring, read for you by Carol Monda. Book One. One. It was the height of the racing season in Saratoga. The thermometer stood over 90, and a haze of sun-powdered dust hung in the elms along the street facing the Grand Union Hotel and over the scant triangular lawns planted with young firs and protected by a low white rail from the depredations of dogs and children. Mrs. St. George, whose husband was one of the gentlemen most interested in the racing, sat on the wide hotel veranda, a jug of iced lemonade at her elbow and a palmetto fan in one small hand, and looked out between the immensely tall white columns of the portico, which so often reminded cultured travelers of the Parthenon at Athens, Greece. On Sunday afternoons, this veranda was crowded with gentlemen in tall hats and frock coats, enjoying cool drinks and Havana cigars, and surveying the long country street planted with spindling elms. But today, the gentlemen were racing, and the rows of chairs were occupied by ladies and young girls listlessly waiting their return in a drowsy atmosphere of suede fans and iced refreshments. Mrs. St. George eyed most of these ladies with a melancholy disfavor and sighed to think how times had changed since she had first, some 10 years earlier, trailed her crinolined skirts up and down that same veranda. Mrs. St. George's vacant hours, which were many, were filled by such wistful reflections. Life had never been easy, but it had certainly been easier when Colonel St. George devoted less time to poker and to Wall Street. When the children were little, crinolines were still worn, and Newport had not yet eclipsed all rival watering places. What, for instance, could be prettier or more suitable for a lady than a black alpaca skirt looped up like a window drapery above a scarlet serge underskirt, the whole surmounted by a wide-sleeved black poplin jacket with ruffled muslin undersleeves and a flat pork pie hat like the one the Empress Eugenie was represented as wearing on the beach at Biarritz. But now there seemed to be no definite fashions. Everybody wore what they pleased, and it was as difficult to look like a lady in those tight, perpendicular polonaises bunched up at the back that the Paris dressmakers were sending over, as in the outrageously low, square-cut evening gowns which Mrs. St. George had viewed with disapproval at the opera in New York. The fact was, you could hardly tell a lady now from an actress, or the other kind of woman. And society at Saratoga, now that all the best people were going to Newport, had grown as mixed and confusing as the fashions. Everything was changed since crinolines had gone out and bustles come in. Who, for instance, was that new woman, a Mrs. Clausen, or some such name, who had such a dusky skin for her auburn hair, such a fat body for her small, uncertain feet, and who, when she wasn't strumming on the hotel piano, was credibly reported by the domestics to lie for hours on her bedroom sofa smoking, yes, smoking, big Havana cigars. The gentleman, Mrs. St. George believed, treated the story as a good joke. To a woman of refinement, it could be only a subject for painful meditation. Mrs. St. George had always been rather distant in her manner to the big and exuberant Mrs. Elmsworth, who was seated at this moment nearby on the veranda. Mrs. Elmsworth was always edging up. Mrs. St. George was instinctively distrustful of the advantages of ladies who had daughters of the age of her own, and Lizzie Elmsworth, the eldest of her neighbor's family, was just about the age of Virginia St. George, and might by some, those who preferred the brunette to the very blonde type, be thought as handsome. And besides, where did the Elmsworths come from, as Mrs. St. George had often asked her husband, an irreverent, jovial man who invariably replied, "If you were to begin by telling me where we do." So absurd on the part of a gentleman as well known as Colonel St. George in some unspecified district of what Mrs. St. George called the South. But at the thought of that new dusky Clausen woman with the queer-looking girl who was so ugly now but might suddenly turn into a beauty, Mrs. St. George had seen such cases, the instinct of organized defense awoke in her vague bosom, and she felt herself drawn to Mrs. Elmsworth and to the two Elmsworth girls, as to whom one already knew just how good-looking they were going to be. A good many hours of Mrs. St. George's days were spent in mentally cataloging and appraising the physical attributes of the young ladies in whose company her daughters trailed up and down the verandas and waltzed and polka'd for hours every night in the long, bare hotel parlors, so conveniently divided by sliding doors which slipped into the wall and made the two rooms into one. Mrs. St. George remembered the day when she had been agreeably awestruck by this vista, with its expectant lines of bentwood chairs against the walls, and its row of windows draped in crimson brocatelle, heavily festooned from overhanging gilt cornices. In those days, the hotel ballroom had been her idea of a throne room in a palace. But since her husband had taken her to a ball at the 7th Regiment Armory in New York, her standards had changed, and she regarded the splendors of the Grand Union almost as contemptuously as the arrogant Mrs. Eglinton of New York, who had arrived there the previous summer on her way to Lake George, and, after being shown into the yellow damask bridal suite by the obsequious landlord, had said she supposed it would do well enough for one night. Mrs. St. George, in those earlier years, had even been fluttered by an introduction to Mrs. Elmsworth, who was an older habitué of Saratoga than herself, and had a big, showy, affable husband with lustrous black whiskers, who was reported to have made a handsome fortune on the New York Stock Exchange. But that was in the days when Mrs. Elmsworth drove daily to the races in a high barouche sent from New York, which attracted perhaps too much attention. Since then, Mr. Elmsworth's losses in Wall Street had obliged his wife to put down her barouche and stay at home on the hotel veranda with the other ladies. And she now no longer inspired Mrs. St. George with awe or envy. Indeed, had it not been for this new Clausen danger, Mrs. Elmsworth in her present situation would have been negligible. But now that Virginia St. George and Lizzie Elmsworth were out, as Mrs. St. George persisted in calling it, though the girls could not see much difference in their lives, now that Lizzie Elmsworth's looks seemed to Mrs. St. George at once more to be admired and less to be feared, and Mabel, the second Elmsworth girl, who was a year older than her own youngest, to be too bony and lantern-jawed for future danger, Mrs. St. George began to wonder whether she and her neighbor might not organize some sort of joint defense against new women with daughters. Later, it would not so much matter, for Mrs. St. George's youngest, Nan, though certainly not a beauty like Virginia, was going to be what was called fascinating, and by the time her hair was put up, the St. George girls need fear no rivalry. Week after week, day after day, the anxious mother had gone over Miss Elmsworth's points, comparing them one by one with Virginia's. As regards hair and complexion, there could be no doubt. Virginia, all rose and pearl, with sheaves of full, fair hair heaped above her low forehead, was as pure and luminous as an apple blossom. But Lizzie's waist was certainly at least an inch smaller, some said two. Lizzie's dark eyebrows had a bolder curve, and Lizzie's foot, where in the world did an upstart Elmsworth get that arrogant instep. Yes, but it was some comfort to note that Lizzie's complexion was opaque and lifeless compared to Virginia's, and that her fine eyes showed temper and would be likely to frighten.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.